What does it take today to keep a company and its brand at the top? Everybody wants to be at the top. What does it really take? A digital industrial revolution is unfolding all around us. What it takes to establish a leading brand is being transformed as well. Years of success could hinge on your company's ability to embrace the new paradigm. But is your brand future-proof? To discuss more future-proofing brands and need for a playbook for the connected era, please welcome our session chair, Anita Nair, COO, Media and Communications, Patanjali Ayurved. And our esteemed panelists, we have Akash Tapse, Senior Vice President, Digital Marketing, AU Small Finance Bank. We have Chanpreet Arora, Business Head of Woot Viacom 80 Digital Ventures. We have Charu Malhotra Bhatia, Vice President, Marketing, Brillouac Limited, the home of the iconic brand Hindware.
That's Brilloka.
I'm sorry?
That's Brilloka.
Brilloka, my bad. I'm so sorry. The Vice President of Marketing Brilloka Limited, the home of iconic brand Hindware. We have Manika Sharma, Head of Marketing Firefox Bike, and Siddharth Dabade, Managing Director, India and the SaaS region of MIQ. Over to you, Ms. Nair.
Thank you so much, Vaibhav. Thanks for the introductions. And it's an absolute honor to be part of such an esteemed panel. I don't know what I'm going to moderate and share, but I'll try my level best to match up to the standards of all the stalwarts in this session. So without further ado, let's just get on with the fact that are we ready for future-proofing brands given the dynamic digital an ever-transforming environment. And, you know, we've all gone through the questions and a few prior discussions. And the perspective is that, you know, how will we future-proof brands when the environment in which the brands are operating is constantly, changing. And if we future-proof today, we will maybe, you know, need to get to future-proofing in another week, another month, maybe a few minutes, few hours, few days, depending on, you know, the way the digital transformation is happening and the technological revolution, if I say, on which the digital transformation is hinged, is kind of evolving every day. I mean, you look at how iPhone, is coming out with models, every year or every 6 months or so, and then you feel that the one in your hand probably is redundant, you know. So there is, how can you write that playbook, when the era is constantly changing? So just over to the panelists, and let me start with Charu. Given that all of us, are from very, very different product categories, Charu, what in your perspective is the fact that will we be in a position to really future-proof our brands going forward? Or, especially, and it'll be nice to really give examples from your categories, because audiences to hear as to, how does a bicycle react vis-a-vis, a Hindware or vis-a-vis a Woot or vis-a-vis the AU banking. And of course, Siddharth, who's the connector to all that. So, Charu.
Sure. I'm audible. I lost you in between. Yeah.
Yes,
you are.
Great. So thank you for getting it started with me, and I'm happy to be here sharing the platform with all others, and eager to hear everybody's viewpoints. And well, as you very rightly said, it's probably not possible to kind of 100% future-proof your brand in the so-called evolution that we've seen over the last couple of years, more so in the last 1.5 years. When everything were, everybody, all businesses, individuals were forced to kind of swap to digital, something which a transformation that could have taken years. I mean, we took a couple of weeks to kind of get there. So yeah, for marketers, this definitely means rethinking how we connect with consumers. We might be able to predict a couple of strategies, but then we will have to keep continuously adapting to what future brings to us in our faces. historically, consumers have had very basic expectations, but now when we see they want more proactive services, they want more personalized interactions, they want connected experiences all through the purchase journey. And more than ever, definitely data and analytics will play a very, very crucial role, not only to track these consumer preferences across their journey at a very, very granular level, but also enabling a very rapid response to opportunities from the brands. And clearly a very, very strong emphasis to e-commerce and other social media channels. Now, when I come to Hindwear, I'm sure all of us will agree, bath spaces and bathrooms were not a very high involvement category up till a decade back. And now with more so with people staying at home, home spaces and bath spaces have acquired a new meaning altogether. I mean, we want to be highly involved with the way we do up our spaces, bath spaces, our homes in general. And that's why customers here also, we've observed this over last couple of years, that customers expect a very connected journey all through the purchase journey. So hence for us, what has been working in our favor is a phygital way of working. So while it is a very distribution-led industry, we have more than 400 brand stores, so it's a brick and mortar retail that works strongly for us with very loyal trade partners in the industry. But then it's become so very important now to connect the customers through a phygital way, where 90%, I mean, we did a research some months back, and we observed that 90% of the searches are happening online, and even the decision-making is happening online. And when does the customer actually step out of the house? That's in the final purchase leg, when he wants to buy the product. And that's where my brick and mortar store needs to be connected to the digital world. So right from social media presence to e-catalogs that we have, where the consumers can see, browse the products at the click of a button, to choosing the best products, to getting quotes from the dealers, again using e-catalogs, to then finally going to a store and then picking it up, maybe for that extra level of conviction that it brings to them, is something that we've been exploring and working on. And that's been working fine for us as on date. Another example could be that this industry really, really boasts of good after-sales service that the consumer would seek for from the brand. And we have just developed a dedicated app apart from the helpline number, because customer today needs various avenues to reach out to the brand. So that's another thing that's probably working fine. And going forward, all these services, marketing, all these platforms will have to be interconnected for an integrated platform. So that's what we are also exploring. We're working. We'll have to explore technologies which allow a very unified workflow solution, we should be able to switch seamlessly from a WhatsApp to a Facebook or a mail. And that technology at Hindwear, I mean, that should allow us to find the customer more than anything else and allow for a very quick response. And that's what the consumer expects right now. I mean, he doesn't care what department he sends a mail at. For example, if he sends a complaint on a social media post, he wants the service department to respond ASAP to him. He wants an answer and he wants it fast. So integrating such platforms, specifically services and marketing, is something that we're looking at strongly. And I think that could be one of the ways where we will be probably able to state that we are future-proof for the next couple of years in some way.
Well, that's interesting, Charu, moving from, you know, talking about phygital and moving from, you know, brick and mortar stores and now on to really journey that you are taking through. I don't remember, you know, visiting a bank in years now, Akshay. So and I saw your latest ads with Kiara Advani and Amir Khan to be telling us more about, you know, you are, you know, whatever offerings are there as far as your bank is concerned. So what is banking, I think, as an industry needs a lot of security and confidentiality. So what are your views on you know, future-proofing the banking and investment industry, so to say?
Thanks, Anita. I think, so First of all, thank you for recognizing or at least acknowledging the efforts we have been trying to put across with the new latest campaign of EU Bank. But I think if I have to come to the question, the basic premise of future-proofing makes you realize, do you even know the future? Right? You can proof it when you know the future. And I think in the last 1.5-2 years, or probably before that only, all the brands and marketeers especially started understanding that understanding future is, or decoding future, I think it's next to impossible. So when it now starts coming on to how banking has been reacting, so banking has been actually at the forefront of driving digital transformation. Overall, all the services, all the products have been getting into that zone far before we faced the entire pandemic about a year and a half back. But then, obviously, in the last couple of years, things have got fastened up quite well. Some things which we have been showing across, like video banking, some things like opening accounts at your from convenience of your home. All of this has been also possible because I think regulators also played an important role on, when I say regulator, RBI in this case, has played an important role on adapting it to it, because obviously banking is a very regulated sort of a industry to be in. And not only the brands, but the regulators playing that role also helps in basically building the entire ecosystem. I think that has geared up, and I think all the banks for that matter have started thinking or started going in that direction. From a bank standpoint, I think you rightly mentioned that data or data confidentiality is an important piece. When you mention everything is, when you're going in future, when you're trying to create more and more databases, when you're trying to know your customers more than probably what he or she knows about themselves, I think confidentiality, security, and probably convenience, if you play this very well in a good equation, I think you can create a proper amount of trust within the customer's mind. If you're able to crack that equation well, I think your brand can, as a banking at least, can move far ahead. So I think, as I said, future-proofing is only possible when you know the future, and which seems to be very difficult as of right now.
Yeah, I agree with you. Nobody knows the future. Nobody knew what was going to happen, what happened to us almost 2 years back. And life is very, very unpredictable, but then all of us have to continue to survive, right? So one thing that we learned in this very unpredictable future was our latching on to entertainment quite a bit, yeah? So my question, Chanpreet, you're smiling, I know, comes to you, is the fact that you being, the head business head of an OTT channel, which is Voot, what is it that you think effective and in your category? Proofing, you think you can? Because to my mind, probably we all know that the consumer's choices are really, really changing, and today we are all talking as brands, but are we really looking at what do consumers want? I know the core. I mean, we everything rotates around the consumers, but we are, I think today as brands, we are becoming even more answerable to consumers. So from an entertainment perspective, where content is something that sailed us through the pandemic, yeah, what do you think is, maybe Voot or Stroke OTT is the future proofing that you guys are looking at? Or can you?
My life, my job and my career depends on it. So I hope we can. And I hope on the other side of it, we come out as disruptors instead of disrupted, which is also a very high probability in anyone's career. But I'd like to start with a thank you so much, Anita, for chairing this session. Can't be more exciting, this diversity in the panel. And I'm saying this with some responsibility, that not because I come from the world of entertainment, but culture drives strategy, culture drives brand building. And I think your purpose of existence has now become a cultural peg rather than an emotional need that we are serving. For consumers in this very disintegrated world where insecurities and unpredictability is very high, rather than selling a utility. To be honest with you, when you mention Apple iPhone, you're not buying a phone, you buy status, right? When I sell a service called Voot, I actually am selling an escape. to my consumers. And I need to acknowledge that. The other big acknowledgement that we have as a brand is that it is impossible for me to reach a mass number of consumers at one go. Like, you know, 15 years ago, even 5 years ago, you know, you'd consider newspaper, television, hoarding, and most marketers would think, I'm there. It's no longer true. People aren't stepping out of the house. People are in subscribed service environments. So what is that new medium through which we can communicate with our consumers? And to us, in our playbook, being true to the session agenda today, there are three things that we've discovered make sense to us. One is our social media engagement across platforms. How we engage with every consumer matters. I acknowledge today that I am competing with Brad Pitt. I'm competing with a news service called Vice, BBC, my mother's cat videos, and my own content when I'm in your social media feed. Do I have a personality, a point of view, my ability to connect with you in those 3 seconds? That matters. And you know, the content that goes on to the short form video app in the tier 2, tier 3 towns is very different content from what goes on to a Facebook, to a Instagram, to a Twitter. So that is one big change in strategy that's coming to us. The second for us, this is something that we do for our brands who partner with us and for ourselves, is becoming contextual. We have stopped looking at our consumers as a demographic audience units. And we have started looking at them in context of their online and offline behavior. So we actually work with cohorts, and we have seen that contextual marketing, content integrations, being contextual to a community is actually very effective with us. At least in our business, being contextual, like if I'm talking to a lady called Ria, and I know that she's an LGBTQ activist, I need to acknowledge that not just in my social media, but the content that I serve to her and how my brand engages with her sensitively through the content. And the third is personalization. We are a premium platform. We have first party locked in data. We, like Akshay said, we have to be very conscious of the data that we take, A, from a security point of view, but we also need to use it to make it a more stress-free experience. 80% of consumers in India, whether it is whether they are radio listeners or TV watchers, they just want passive programming. Whether we like it or not, even in VOD, they want passive programming. And so it is our duty to become more relevant and personalized in that. I think these are the three big things that matter to us. So I hope that sums it up.
Yeah, so interesting. I'm with you on the fact that, you know, we need to be contextual, and, you know, if a brand ceases to be relevant to its audiences, there is no point. Yeah, and also I think very importantly, understanding of our audiences as to, you know, online, offline is in our minds, but when you view yourself as an audience, you no longer say that, oh, I'm watching TV, so it is offline, and I'm watching, you know, something on Facebook, and that's online. So that also as marketers is something that we've created the divide in our mind. So I think what is important is to really look at the customer, you know, what is it that the customer wants? How is the customer behavior? Those insights into consumer behavior or customer behavior are important, which really is a mix, is the basic pillar for, you know, us to really dwell on. So Siddharth, I'm sorry, I'll come to you last because you are the connector in the whole process. So over to you, Manika. Very interesting category of Firefox. And just before the pandemic, or not really before, but just before the second wave hit, my daughter wanted to, you know, desperately buy a Firefox. So I went and bought her one. Yeah. So the connect with the brand happened there at the brick and mortar store. You know, where I was. And honestly, I did not check anything digitally as far as Firefox is concerned, but just went to a Firefox distributor close by and went and just saw, touch, feel, a bit of a run. And they said, yeah, this is what she wanted to buy. So what, according to you, when we are talking about the entire era of digitization, yeah, is a category like yours looking at from a future-proofing perspective?
Yeah, thanks, Anita. Thanks. I'm glad you picked up a Firefox. First of all, really happy to be part of this panel and get to hear diverse views on such an interesting topic. Honestly, a very relevant topic for these times. You spoke about the distinction we always made with offline and online. So I think in order to be future-proof, if at all we can attempt at being future-proof, is to actually break the mental models that worked for centuries. So the traditional IDA and funnel approach doesn't work anymore. Consumers, Chantri spoke about consumers being, always connected and always consuming content. So how do you really break that clutter? How do you become relevant for consumers? I think that's the challenge that brands face. Obviously last few years, digitization has revolutionized consumer journeys, but now the pandemic has been another inflection point where, the pace at which consumer expectations have transformed during the pandemic, it's bound to have long-term impact. So for us as a brand, definitely, we've invested in a complete digital transformation where we are not looking at media or we're not looking at consumer interaction in silos. We're trying to map the consumer's journey with the brand, end to end. I think that is the key. So not looking at different touch points in isolation. So let's say for a social media handle to a physical retail store, to the events that we do. Normally, traditionally, everything was approached in a very disintegrated manner, and there's a media KPI that you assign to a particular touch point. I think that doesn't work anymore. So you need to, and in order for us to become relevant for the consumers, it's important to understand where exactly is the customer with the interaction with the brand. So I think that would be the key to future-proof yourself, so to say. So for us, for example, even post-purchase, it is important to create those interactions to encourage and enable product use. For Firefox, we want to create a culture of biking, cycling in India. And therefore, it has to go beyond product purchase because a lot of consumers, especially during pandemic, picked up a bicycle but never actually got to ride it. It's been lying there. So as a brand, the onus to not only sell the product but also ensure that and engage customers for usage of the product is important. And therefore, we do a lot of events. We started a virtual events. Anything which enables a customer to use the product more and more, facilitates that consumption. So I think that is that's the relevance that you create. So you become part of the brand's life. It's not about, you sell a particular product and then you're out. You become a part of consumers' lives so that they keep coming back to you. And that's how the brand advocacy also builds. One thing that I would like to say is that while a lot has changed, but one thing that I think will always remain is the purpose, that Chanpreet spoke about. Every brand needs to have a purpose, and whatever you do, you remain true to that purpose. As long as you have that as the goalpost, everything else, of course, is extremely volatile and ever-changing.
Sure, completely with you, Manika. So what I'm hearing is a lot of personalization, customization, relevance, contextual, obviously consumer journey, various data points, security, and of course, purpose or benefit, the brand benefit, which comes to a person. So we have got so many dots, Siddharth. How do you think in your, scheme of things, because you are, from not really a brand category, so to say, but a connector of brand and audiences. So what in your perspective is this attempt to future-proof leading to? Over to you.
Yeah. I think so. I agree with all the points, and first priority for a brand is to kind of establish itself, and that's where a good connect with consumer, good understanding of the consumer really matters. And then from there, how do you kind of track the changes in the consumer behavior, consumer expectations, and how do you probably keep ahead of it as well? Those things really matter. And I think there are three more points I will just add. And I'm also coming from tech, data, and platform perspective. So one is definitely how can a brand create an ecosystem where there are a lot of dots getting connected in terms of, you know, you have a lot of collaborators in your industry with you, basically, right? And that, for example, if I just take a tech platform, which is like Amazon, right? So the way tech platforms have always been successful is by creating an ecosystem where there are a lot of developers, there are a lot of partners, and they are developing a lot of stuff on top of that. And hence, there's an entire ecosystem which is getting generated. And so to speak, you are not only, you not only created a brand, but you are also kind of creating a disruption. Instead of being disrupted, you are the disruption, basically. And that's where not only you are being with the future, but you are actually able to define the future. So that is point number one, right? The second point is that diversification is very, very critical. It's not always possible to create a platform like that. But then if you are well diversified, and I will give a simple example here again. We will have in a couple of years time cookieless paradigm coming in. So are you as a brand dependent on your digital channels with cookies, and how much are you dependent on? And then what are the other you know, like device IDs and other channels which you are developing, which will help you when cookieless paradigm actually comes in? You can rely on other channels to still have a good consumer understanding, and your business is almost not affected because of this change in paradigm, right? So that is the second point. Diversification definitely helps. And again, you know, we have a data lake which has 700 million consumers data in India, both online and offline. And the way we have looked at it is that, yes, there is a portion of data which is basis cookies, but 80% of our data is basis other, you know, channels like device IDs, then contextual signals, other channels which are not dependent on cookies, like digital out of home, connected TV, and so on. So from that perspective, yes, 20% business or 20% of the data will get affected when cookieless paradigm will come in. And I'm sure there will be a solution for that as well. So the net impact might be just about 5%, for which we are already ready. And we are also working with a lot of brands to help them get ready in that. And the third point I would say is that I think, you know, as rightly being said here, future is completely unknown. So the ability to shift the shape is very, very critical. So the ability to pivot, how adaptable is your organization and your brand? That is something which kind of has to be an yearly assessment in your reviews. And then, you know, and possibly how can you keep building muscles for adaptability is something which is very, very critical. So yeah, that would be the shape-shifting ability would be the third point, which is very, very critical in my mind.
Thanks for your perspective, Siddharth. And I'm sure the panel would agree, you know, on the various things that Siddharth has touched upon. And given the fact that everything today is completely tech-based. So while we're talking about, you know, future-proofing, and I think if I can take the liberty of saying the panel agrees, when we don't know about the future, what are we going to proof really? Yeah, but the fact is that two very important things which to my mind matter most is A, as Siddharth said, adaptability. You know, so adaptability and resilience, I think, are two things that really is something that the brands will have to go with, irrespective of whatever future we are looking at. You guys have, in your own you know, discussion points, mentioned various things that brands can leverage to try and future-proof. Yeah, and also that, you know, what is it that we need to do if we have to gaze into the future and be relevant all through brand existence, be really relevant to our consumers and not look at them as SEC, you know, ABC residing in a male, female, 25 plus kind of target audiences, which in yesteryears we used to do a lot of demography there. Just a quick do you think there is a sacred playbook that brands really need to play by? I would fathom no, because you know you can only do a playbook if you are very sure about whatever, but will be very interesting to you know, get your brands can leverage if you were to future proof. Like I said, part of it has already been discussed, but a perspective from all of you. Start with Akshay and then move.
Yeah, Anita. So before we move to that, I think one thing I could mention is we talked about adaptability. We've talked about the entire shifting and changing of behavior. I think that's something which coherence with our brand campaign also about saying Badlav. I think that's something which I've seen a lot of brands actually talking in that direction. Every brand wants to have a change. Every brand wants to talk about a change. From a banking standpoint, if I tell you if there is a playbook, then that has to be revised or re-looked upon. I don't know if it's in months or weeks, but definitely not in years. That's for sure. So even if we create something and if we try creating those sort of a playbooks, those will still be more of a guidance. Those will be more like probably in the next, what do you do if these things happen? Or what do you do for a sustainability growth? So something like cookie-less sort of a environment, what Siddharth just mentioned. Now, while we understand that something is a future in the next couple of years, how do we build or how do we strategize ourselves in creating first-party data? How do we start enhancing our first-party data and try building models on that? I think that's the only guidance which that playbook can give. Obviously, what changes, how it changes, that is fully dependent on various other partners which are beyond our control. These are all ecosystem partners who are driving it. Also, I think there's an interesting point which Siddharth brought out was, how do we create an ecosystem? Something which a lot of brands are trying to create, like even banking is trying to create banking as a platform. It's also notably called as BAP. But then that's how, that's something, I think with these new age brands, fintechs, new banks coming in. I think that's an area where banking is also trying to move into. And if that becomes successful, then we are actually talking in the ranges of probably creating platforms like the biggies, like Amazons and the Googles of the world. Obviously, it will sooner or less, it will start consolidating into some piece, which will be a issue probably in a longer run. But I think that's where we could be heading to if we are trying to go in that direction of creating platforms. One more piece which I think I would like to mention out here is Manika mentioned that online offline has started, obviously, and he also he coded that there is no differentiation. I think one more piece which has been happening and which is growing also is the lack of differentiation between a branding sort of a spends versus a performance sort of a spends. See, banking has always been very heavy on performance. I mean, that's how we started. That's how we explored digital world. We all love numbers a lot. And that's the reason I think performance, we could get that number right on the dashboard. So I think everyone loved to see those sort of a conversions. Now that branding came into picture, obviously there were two legs of it. And for a longer period of time, these were two running in a connected way, but still in silos in some sort. I think what we are running right now as a campaign on digital platforms, we have just merged both of these together, because technically there is nothing which is only branding or there's nothing which is only performance. Both of these things do simultaneously each other's work. And hence we are looking at it as a holistic sort of a approach out there. And that is what we are also seeing, that will not only translate from, because I know a few of the offline players which also work on a performance sort of a metrics. So I think this will start growing as we move ahead. And because everyone obviously would like to know what they're getting in return for every dollar spent in advertising, right? So that will, I think that's a move which will happen. Finally, I think you mentioned about getting a Firefox bike about 6 months or a year back. Banking is still not achieved to a level where people say that, hey, you know what, I want to get an open an account. I have not frankly seen anyone doing that. I think the idea is, how do we create banking as an ecosystem or as a brand where people start relating it with their daily lives? See, everyone banks every day almost. Everyone does some payments every day, but they don't realize it. I mean, it has started getting into that utility era. where banking may become like one of the utilities, like probably your water or your electricity or something like that. And you don't care at the end of the day which brand is giving you electricity at your home, right? So I think for banking, it will be this challenge of how do you make sure you're not a utility, but a brand which people likes to connect with emotionally. And if you're, and as a whole or industry, if you're able to make sure that does not happen, I think that's great for everybody.
I echo what you're saying, Akshay. And in fact, I wanted to mention this, but, I was a little scared to mention it, but I said, see, your Badlav campaign that you are running, actually what you're saying is nothing new, right? You're just saying it in a very different way, whether it is, connecting through video, whether it is giving various facilities and all. But what is more important there is actually the platform,
right?
So you are actually selling the service through a platform, though what you are selling in terms of USPs is something that, people know, or people are aware of. And hence this whole thing about branding versus performance that you were talking about, if there is no awareness, how can you lead to performance? It's as simple as that. So to my mind also, branding and performance really have to go hand in hand. And when I was in an agency, it used to be very interesting for clients to come and say, humko sirf performance karna hai. We only want conversions, and then one would wonder and say, but who are you? The consumer is going to ask you, who are you for me to really consider you? So given that situation, Charu, what do you think in the category that you're talking about? And I launched Kohler in the country, so I know how uninvolving and uninteresting a category like yours can be, for customers and to get their attention, to sell. Becoming extremely expensive in today's day and age. I mean, doing up a bathroom costs you lakhs today. Yeah, it's no longer a thing about a pot and a bathtub and some faucets. Yeah? So that's interesting because yours is a very, very drab category, dry category. Sorry for sorry.
I feel it's not there anymore. I mean, people are really, really doing up their bath spaces tastefully.
Yes. Yes.
They're personifying their bath spaces. So, yeah, it's.
Yes, so I'm saying from a category where it was used to be, very uninteresting and not so involving, and you would leave it to your, the contractor or the architect or whoever was doing it, to making this category so interesting today, where people are spending, and I've seen some amazingly expensive bathrooms that all the Nourish are creating today. So what, according to you, is if at all, the need for creating a playbook in this era, and what are certain things that you can leverage and certain tools that you can use? You did touch upon that in your earlier comment, but it will be nice to consolidate and hear them now.
Yeah, so taking on from there only, so I've covered some bit of it, but taking on from there, yes, the category has seen a major, major revolution and transformation. And what we've been seeing now is that there is an explosion of the number of mediums or channels that the consumer is now seeking to reach out to the brand. And it's not just that as a brand, I want to reach out to the consumers. For them also, they're using various number of channels. And the mediums have just proliferated over last years. So hence, as I mentioned, a very uniform integrated platform or a data warehouse is something that we need. And as you rightly mentioned, consumers are spending a lot on bathrooms. But more than that, it is also important for us. I mean, we've also done a lot of work, the industry, to kind of create that kind of an aspiration for the bath space. And hence, a lot of advertising spends, whether it is on mass media, digital. So there's, I would want to take one case here, one project that we've currently started with, and not just reaching out to the right audience at the right time. This is also helping me optimize my ad spends, and that probably is the way forward. So we're trying this on our website. So customers, when I talk about Hindware, they come through various sources, offline, online. All my brand stores, there are about 10,000 touch points that I have. Then there is social media presence, website, app, and lot more. So what is important is right now what we're doing is we are combining, we are storing, we are processing this database, this first party customer database, as Akshay also rightly pointed out. And this is then being used to calculate the customer life cycle value. So bathrooms, it's not that it's like once you've done your bathroom and you're done, you're sorted for like 10 years, 20 years now. People are changing it every couple of years, 3 years, 4 years. And plus there is also a lot of focus that has come on upgrading. There are powder bathrooms that have come up, which did not exist maybe a decade back. So there are a lot of opportunities where you can upgrade, where you can calculate their the customer's life cycle value. Then there is customer conversion time that I can track through this. Then we can implement the right omni channel that we can support to sales and conversions at the brand store. So again, the phygital way, combining digital and taking it to the brand store. Apart from that, it is also what we are also doing here is we are creating a 360 degree consumer profile so that the right kind of leads come to me and I direct my advertising spends to reaching out to the right customer. So we are mapping his user journey, complete user journey through multiple devices, whether it is his screen, whether it is TV, whether it is Facebook, whether it is any other social media that he's wanting to reach out to me, and then develop a customized personal profile and then reaching out to him. So again, speed is important here. I have to act fast. So targeting consumer on the right platform where he's interacting with me and then giving him a personalized communication. That's something that we've started at Hindwear a couple of weeks back. I would say it's as latest as that. So we've just done a pilot and it's, so for example, if there's a customer who's just browsed my website and he's returning, then I'll send him a WhatsApp, I'll send him an SMS, we're sending him push notifications and we're sending him to the nearest store. So the push notification will also send the address of the near me searches, the nearest store, so that then it converts into hyperlocal lead generation and closure for the trade partner. So that's that he also gets that support from the brand. And while we do all this data churning and this warehouse that we've created, this then further goes in developing these AI modules or models, as I call it, which are based on consumer behavior. So this helps us identifying any VIP customers that I have, the propensity of the actual customer, the kind of conversion that I can go ahead with, and also helps me reduce my ad wastage. So in a turn, something like this is definitely going to help us, I mean, as we move forward in future to kind of optimize my ad spends and also reach out to the right audience, because it's important to tap the consumer when he's in that process of home renovation. This is not an FMCG that I go, I mean, I see the ad, I like the packet of chips and I go and buy it. He has to be in that phase of purchase. He has to be in that phase of renovating his house. So how I capture him, how I send him the right info, how I direct him to my store. I mean, that consumer journey is very important. So, yeah.
I'm sure, Charu, I'm a poor customer and with, you know, the various touch points. And if you look at yourselves as consumers and you're getting an SMS, you're getting a notification, you know, you open your social media account and there's an ad there. And if you're on television, you see an ad, on newspaper, you see an ad. My God. Inundation, but
I would say that this is more of a hand holding of that journey, because as I told you, I'm not targeting a consumer who's not in that phase. I'm targeting a consumer who's searching for the products.
You know, the diverse categories that we all are representing, you know. So, and one very important thing, and I think you touched upon that pretty interestingly, speed. Yeah, so it is one thing which we cannot afford to lax is on speed or being agile, you know, and there is, I think, nobody better than the entertainment sector, which is so Chanpreet, over to you for your perspective on, you know, playbooking, leveraging various tools, and what is it that the future holds for us?
Okay, so I'll be honest with you, for us, and I'm sure Manika would specifically relate to this, is that there is fandom around certain brands, right? There is this love and passion, and entertainment kind of thrives on it. On a very lighter note, I've represented certain brands in my career where I would have to actually sit with the screen that is this person lying just to get a job with this company, because there's so much attraction to this fandom of this brand. And that's the way we work. one of the big things that we made, coming back to talk about the playbook, you know, you made a very important point, both Manika and Anita, that the difference between offline and online is only in our heads as marketers. But the consumer journey has blurred those lines. And we acknowledged that 3 years ago as a broadcaster, where we said, listen, if I look at Viacom 18, 4 years ago, it launched Voot, its own OTT app. It's probably one of the first ones that came into the market. 2 years ago, a proposition for our fans became Before TV and Anytime. So today you could watch an episode of Big Boss OTT if you're truly a big loyal fan of Big Boss season 15. If you're truly a loyal fan Before TV, if you become a paid sub. And you can watch it 24/7, something you couldn't watch on TV because you're sitting at home and you're in the lockdown and this is what you want to do. You know, we actually innovated and released that. I'm just telling you how the product evolved. Voot's biggest driver was its fans that wanted to consume it anytime. Today, we are more gamified than any other OTT. For every piece of non-fiction content that we create, it's almost like living in a real-time game. And we started doing this only because we realized that our fans wanted to engage with the content. It now had to become a two-way communication. Then we actually have gone now one step further and we've realized that being in the pop culture movement is so important, not just for our fans, but also for the brands who want to engage in it, that rather than just simply advertising around the content, we've opened up our content to advertisers and said, come, please participate and be a part of the content rather than just being around it. So we're taking that journey and you know, this goes back to what Charu was also saying. You know, you actually connect the intent, the pop culture moment and the fandom consumer together. We can't really look at now I'm going to do spot advertising. Now I'm going to do, emailer blast. If I don't understand the journey of the consumer, if I don't build the awareness and the love, there won't be any conversions. So, yeah, aligned with that.
Sure, Chanpreet, with you on that, because I think interestingly, more and more that we are talking about it, the mapping of the consumer journey and obviously, for the lack of another word, the touch points where you can connect with the consumer are becoming very important. So while you are connecting through those touch points with the consumer, I think as marketers, we should never forget, and I don't think we forget, that A, we have to be relevant to them, and B, the entire brand experience and the engagement with the consumer is something that is very, very important. So with that, Manika, in your case, as you said that, again, there is an offline and online in terms of being brick and mortar, being there. And then even the journey afterwards. And the fact that people are not cycling these days by creating events and, bringing that fandom in for Firefox there is so much more that needs to be done, really, and to me, I think all those departments where we were compartmentalizing things to say, ye TV hai, ye print hai, ye outdoor hai, is no more relevant. See, for the consumers, it was never relevant. For them, it was like, consuming it on the go. It was, for us, it was relevant. But I think those lines are blurring. And as like Charu was mentioning, or Akshay was mentioning, this whole integration piece is becoming extremely important. So Manika, with your comments, and then we will close with Siddharth to connect, as I said, Siddharth, connect all of us together as various brands. So over to you, Manika.
Yeah, Anita. So, to your question that can brands have a playbook, honestly speaking, all life cycles are shortening. Attention spans are shortening. So even if we have a playbook, it'll be very short-lived. It needs to be constantly looked at, disrupted, questioned. And each brand will have to, define its own playbook because, like we said, customer journeys are extremely important and it's very different from category to category. So brands will have to define their own playbook. So for example, I'll pick up an example from the cycling category. So post-pandemic cycling category completely transformed from, transportation, a medium of transportation to transformation, So, and we had very less time as a brand to adopt and adapt. Otherwise, you're not relevant anymore. So, you know, for example, one of the things in the, I think Charu and Chanpreet spoke about the digital world, but the physical aspect of it, you know, the retail space. So typically, traditionally, when cycles were looked at purely as a medium of communication, transportation, if you look at any traditional cycle store, it's just a lot of cycles placed next to each other. It's not a very good experience. It does not enable customer decision making. So that's when we've recently launched a store in Navi Mumbai, which we call our experience center. It has a very, very different retail identity. There are just very few marquee products displayed. The entire objective is to enable customers' decision making inside the store, so that the experience with the brand, it's not about putting all the products that you have in your portfolio out there, but in ensuring that the customer makes the decision, makes the right choice. And there are tools and certain engagement tools inside the store to enable engagement even beyond purchases. So that's the kind of transformation that brands have to undergo, and very less time. Like I said, just about 6 months, were we ready to absorb that kind of demand and still remain relevant as a brand is a challenge. So I think, yes, playbooks, very short-lived and will have to be redefined by brands.
With you on that, Manika. Siddharth, we just short on time, so just about 5 minutes remaining for you for your closing remarks, and I'll just wrap it up in one sentence after that. Over to you.
Yes, absolutely. So yeah, I think I agree. It's very difficult to have a playbook, and I will say that probably one defining element of a playbook can be experimentation. You have to keep doing a lot of experiments and do a lot of pilots. And many of the panelists talked about their initiatives, and some will succeed, some will not, which is fine. But the point is that there have to be some new initiatives, some pilots, some experiments, which are always happening, and then that will lead to innovations, right? And just to add as an example, so we have a case study with L'Oreal, where what we did was we created a beauty index where when consumers in the right target group, they are online. And we are collecting those signals and creating an index. And when they are also searching for L'Oreal products and beauty related products. So combining all these data signals, we created a real time index. And then we synced the campaign. The bidding increased and decreased according to the way the index increased or decreased. So when consumers are browsing more about L'Oreal products, or searching more about L'Oreal products, we are increasing the intensity of the campaign and vice versa. And this was initially like, started a pilot, and then we saw very good results, and then we extended it, right? So it's a great example of two things. One is how do you look into the macro data which is affecting the consumer brand behavior, and then in the right moment you are being relevant to the consumer in a very good way. That is one. And second, more important point is you started with a pilot, you saw that it is succeeded, and then you kind of scaled it up. And that's where you need to keep doing that again and again and build templates out of it. And yes, this year's playbook might not work out in the next year, but as long as you have a plethora of experiments going, you will have some successes, and then you can scale that for the next year playbook for you.
Great. Thank you so much, Siddharth. So now almost on time. And my closing comments from everybody who said there, firstly, I mean, there is no question on customer is the king or consumer is the king. Yeah, what is very important is, the relevance of data and technology, which is the backbone for the digital transformation in today's day and age. Future proofing, obviously, we don't know about future, what are we going to prove? But I personally think that, there is need for a playbook. The only thing is that the playbook is going to change very fast. Because to me, a playbook will, at any given point in time will exist as, combination of a culmination of a lot of experiences, a lot of, innovations that we've done. And those experiences and innovations and our understanding will then lead us to write the another chapter in the playbook. So maybe our playbook, will be this thick with far too many chapters, and we'll have to write them really, really fast with a lot of agility. And of course, the richness of this conversation from various categories has been, a pleasure for me, at least. And I'm sure you guys would have also loved the conversation. So thank you, Chanpreet, Manika, Charu, Siddharth, Akshay, and thank you, Simran, Ritika, and E4M for having us on this panel. Thank you so much. And Vaibhav, you too. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks, Anita. Thanks, everyone.